of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, remain standing again as we'll be singing the Star Spangled Banner.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, with broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous night, o'er the ramparts we walked were so gallantly streaming, and the
We just thank you for this day, Lord, the day that you have set aside for us to come together as a body and, Lord, to worship you and to hear from your word and to fellowship, Lord. And, Lord, specifically on this 4th of July weekend, Lord, we just want to thank you for this great country you placed us in. It's not perfect, Lord, but it's definitely a country that you have blessed, Lord. And I know we've turned our back on you, and I pray that this nation can turn back to you again, Lord, that we can see a revival sweep through this land, the land that you have so blessed, Lord. Even with just the blessing of being able to meet freely, Lord, we have brothers and sisters in Christ, Lord, who are meeting today, but they're meeting silently because of persecution. But we can meet openly, Lord, and we can sing these songs as loud as we can. And, Lord, I pray that we take the freedom of religion we have, Lord, and the freedom to worship you, and we do not hide our light, Lord, but use it so much the more to let the light shine, Lord, and we can see many people come to know you. Lord, I pray you be with this service. Pray everything brings you honor and glory. I pray you be with Pastor as he preaches your word. I pray you fill him with the Holy Spirit so we can leave here changed, closer to the image of your Son. And if someone here is not saved, they never called upon you for salvation, I pray today will be the day that they call upon you and accept the free gift of grace. Lord, we thank you for everything you've done, and we thank you for that which you continue to do. We pray for these things in your Son's name. Amen. You may be seated.
All right, our next congregational song that we're going to sing is God Bless America. There is a verse that goes along with this. I'm going to sing that verse for you, and then I ask that you join me on the chorus.
While the storm clouds gather far across the sea, let us swear allegiance to a land that's free. Let us all be grateful for a land so fair, as we raise our voices in a solemn prayer. God bless us. Land that I and guide her through the night with a light from above, from the mountain to the prairies, to the oceans white with foam. God bless America, my
First of all, I want to say thank you for everyone who donated to the teen yard sale. It was for our first year, it was a really good yard sale. I think the teens brought in just right around $1,100. But just thank you guys for your help and for the people who helped work it and just for praying and for donating. So a couple quick announcements for the teenagers. First of all, this Friday, July the 7th, is Blast Rally at Crossroads. We are leaving here at 5:15, and we should be back right around 9 o'clock. When it ends, I will text the parents. Also, 2 weeks from tomorrow, it's hard to believe, but is when we are going to camp on Monday, July 17th. Parents, I know I've given you some of you how much you owe left, but if I've not given that to you, please see me and I will get it to you. Money needs to be paid before we go up on the 17th. Also, we are leaving here on the 17th at 8 a.m., meaning teens need to be here no later than 7:45 so we can get everything packed up and we can leave here right at 8 a.m. And for 7:45, no later, so we can leave here at 8. If you have any questions about that, please see me. But those are my announcements. I'll give it back to Pastor.
All right, let's test your knowledge here, okay? How many signatures are on the Declaration of Independence? That's not a good start, okay? Come on. I know some of you know the answer, just don't want to share it. What is it? Close. I'll give you A for effort there, okay? But 56 names, okay? Where was the Declaration of Independence stored during World War II? Look, you know, when I don't want you to talk in church, you talk. When I want you to talk, you don't want to say anything.
Tony says Fort Knox.
Yes, that's exactly right. Give that man 100%. Yes, Fort Knox, okay? Now, I won't ask you to name all these, but which six men are considered the founding fathers of America? George Washington, John Adams, Thomas Jefferson, Benjamin Franklin, James Madison, and Alexander Hamilton. Okay, I have a few more for you right before we preach this morning. A couple of cards that I forgot to read. Again, wanted to say thanks to the church for celebrating Dave's birthday a couple weeks ago. So that's the card there. I'll put that on the back table when you get a chance. And then also here, thank you for all your prayers and support during my surgery and recovery. God was with me through it all. There was so much evidence of his presence from hospital staff and doctors to the recovery. Please continue to pray for the next phase of my healing process as I go through radiation. Thank you so much, and God bless you. That is from Marlene Brown. Okay, and I apologize for not reading those sooner, but I will put them out there on the table if you'd like to read those over. Okay, sign-up sheet there in the, that's not in the bulletin here. Sign-up sheet is there for lasagna. That's not this Tuesday, but next Tuesday. Is that right? I don't see my next Tuesday. Okay. So next Tuesday, there's also a sign-up for this Saturday shower for Sarah from 11 until 1. That's, I think that is in the bulletin there. I can't remember, but I read it somewhere. She has a shower there, 11 to 1. But there's a sign-up sheet there in the back. A drop-in shower is scheduled for Brittany and their baby Renji on at 2 o'clock next Sunday? Today, next Sunday. Next Sunday, okay? All right. Then there's also Josie's family shower is July the 29th, okay? And I know if you get tired of those showers, just tell those people stop having babies, okay? But I went to church and the pastor, and I think I shared this with you before, the pastor told us you can grow the church one of two ways. You can go out soul winning, or you can have children, one of the two, okay? So, and we'll take both, all right? Today, again, the secret sister is being, your secret sister is being revealed to this morning after the evening service. That's going to take place back in the teen room, okay? Back in the teen room, it's a little bit more quiet than people going in and through the fellowship hall, okay? So that'll be right after the morning service. Isn't that what I said? Oh, you can't do it during the evenings, after the evening service, because we're going to Burger King for ice cream, okay? That's for anybody who'd like to go up to Burger King. You can get something else if you want, but I'm going there for the ice cream, okay? So we'll be doing that. We did that, I think, last year and had 30, 40 people show up. So if you'd like to come out to Burger King after the evening service tonight, we're going to have ice cream there in the time of fellowship, okay? But after the morning service, Secret Sister will be being revealed back in the teen room, okay? Monday is men's breakfast at Burger King at 8 o'clock. If you have that day free, gentlemen, we'd love to have you stop by and fellowship there. Ladies, coffee and fellowship at Bigby every Wednesday. And then, of course, remind you about the counseling ministry as well. Again, there is a table back there with some materials, again, that might be a help to you, maybe a help to somebody that you know and would like to get purchase that for them. Somebody asked me, are we having together Tuesday, this Tuesday? Yes, we are, okay? It's July 4th, I know, but you come. Josiah will be our speaker this week. That was scheduled a while back. Because at that we soon at that time, that'd be the first time he'd be bringing his baby, his son, to church with him. But they had already been here a couple of weeks ago because the doctors took the baby early. But he's going to be our guest speaker. I don't know if they're shooting off fireworks someplace around here on the 4th, but you'll be out before dark, okay? I'll make sure he doesn't preach for that long. Let's see. Pastor Ryan already mentioned the blast rally. Baby showers were mentioned. Oh, business meeting next week, Sunday night for the members. Again, we'll be having a business meeting. Number one thing we're voting on is air conditioning for the church. Okay, it does need to be replaced. Should be getting both of those quotes sometime this week. And if we don't, we're still going to have the vote because I know you don't want to sit here without air conditioning. Okay, all right. It's running, but it's not able to keep up. It's not working properly. So it's just an old air conditioning unit. So we do need to purchase a new one. So we'll be voting on that and a couple other things next week, Sunday night. Men's advance again. That needs to be in. Is that next week, Sunday? Next week, Sunday. Men, if you're going for that, again, $20. If you're just going one of the days, if you're going both days, it is $40. I encourage you to do that. It's a little bit of a trip over there, but you'll be excited about that time to fellowship, but also the speakers that are preaching on that day. And then ladies' retreat, again, continue to sign up. There's still room, I think, at this point to sign up. The ladies, that's October 13th and 14th at Camp Kobiak. Okay. All right, Miss Cheryl, yes. Okay.
So the names will be Kim, Jane, Terry, and Stephanie.
Okay. All right. If you have any questions about that, see Cheryl before you leave, okay? Appreciate, again, all those that help out at the Together Tuesday, bringing food, cleaning up, setting up, and all those things. Appreciate you doing that. Again, yesterday, I know it was in a long couple of days for several of the teenagers and a couple of the adults who helped with the garage sale, but I'm telling you, when it came time to clean up, all those people, it went really, really fast. I appreciate, again, all the work that was done there, okay? All right, if we can get the ushers to come, we'll go ahead and take up the morning offering. Now, don't be thinking about Burger King and ice cream right now. You can think about that later tonight, okay? I understand today is somebody's birthday, and we're not singing half birthday, but today is Joey's birthday. So he thinks we're going to Burger King to get him ice cream. But the way I understand it, if it's your birthday, you buy it for everybody else. So Joey will be buying everybody an ice cream cone tonight. Right, Joey? No? All right. All right. I'm going to ask Brother Gene if he'll pray for the offering, please.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day. And Father, we just thank you for the meaning of what the 4th of July is in our lives, Lord, that today we have the freedom to stand here and worship you, Lord, and bow our heads in prayer. And Lord, we just thank you for being able to meet openly without any repercussions, Lord. We thank you for your goodness, for your freedoms in our lives. We thank you, Lord, for this day that you have set aside for us. And Lord, we just pray today that if there's someone here that's not saved, Lord, that today would be the day of salvation for them. And Lord, we ask that you'll use these tithes and offerings for your honor and glory, Lord. And Father, the furtherance of the gospel. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Pendle for that. Oh, beautiful for spacious skies. Great rendition. All right, we'll be singing our next congregational song, God of Our Fathers. There's some introductions into it, so just watch me as we start God of Our Fathers.
Shining words in
Amen. If you're able to stand, would you join me as we sing our final song, My Country, 'Tis of Thee, Sweet Land of Liberty.
Thank you.
And thank you, Tyson, the family for that. I appreciate that. We do live in a great country. It does have its flaws, obviously, but I would still choose to live here rather than any place in the world. If you are 4 years old up through the fourth grade, you can go ahead and be dismissed at this time for children's church. Those that are 4 years old up through the fourth grade, go ahead and be dismissed. And just a reminder for those, again, that tonight, again, the children will all meet in here to begin with, and we'll dismiss them like we do in the morning service, okay? Couple of other trivia things here. Number one is, how many times does a Liberty Bell ring on each Independence Day? Thirteen. Which three U.S. presidents died on the 4th of July?
John Adams, Thomas Jefferson.
That's easy to remember because they both died on the same day in the same year, okay? But there was another one that died on the 4th. Who is that? Where am I at? Sorry, I got to look it up. Yes, James Monroe. Thank you, James Monroe. All right. So July 4th, not a good day for presidents. They'll be glad when this day is over with. I don't know. According to the National Hot Dog and Sausage Council, roughly how many hot dogs are eaten on the 4th of July? Yeah, 150 million hot dogs. That's a lot of hot dogs. According to the American Pyrotechnics Association, that's how many of you are a part of, a member of one of those? Okay, yeah, okay. My brother was, if he hadn't been saved, would probably have been a pyromaniac. I don't know. But how much did Americans spend last year on fireworks? Anybody guess? No, of course not. I know that. But $2.3 billion to watch a sparkler. I don't know. I've never been fascinated with that. I mean, it's kind of cool, don't get me wrong, but I could do with or without fireworks, but I know that there are many that just love that. In a couple of days, we will be celebrating the 247th anniversary of the official signing of the Declaration of Independence. Interested in what our country will do on year 250. In just a few more years, we'll be celebrating that, 250 years since the signing of the Declaration of Independence. If we'll still have a country, I don't know. It'd be interesting. Yeah, it's a day to remember the freedom that has long been sought. You know, I can't remember which president it was, but it might have been John Adams. I don't remember. One of the presidents would never celebrate the 4th of July because in his mind, the official day of independence was July 2nd. July 2nd is when all those got together and agreed that that was going to be what they did, but the official vote and signing everything was on July 4th. So oftentimes he would be invited to come someplace on July 4th, and he refused to do it because the Independence Day to him was July the 2nd. But our forefathers founded this country with faith and freedom in mind would be appalled at what has become of this country today. Let me give you a few quotes by our leaders of the past. Patrick Henry said, "It cannot be emphasized too strongly or too often that this great nation was founded not by religionists, but by Christians. Not on religions, but on the gospel of Jesus Christ." John Quincy Adams said, "The highest glory of the American Revolution was this, that it connected one indissoluble bond, the principles of civil government, with the principles of Christianity." Far cry from today. John Jay, first Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, said, "Providence has given to our people the choice of our rulers, and it is the duty as well as the privilege and interest of a Christian nation to select and prefer Christians for their rulers." Interesting, again, as I had the privilege of teaching this next quarter, teaching our young adults in their Sunday school class, and what we're talking about choosing biblical patterns for our lives. And one of those things we talked about today, again, is only 21%, ages 18 to 29, only 21% of those people go to church weekly. Do you realize that in that age group here in our church, 18 to 29, they make up 13% of our church? That's a small number. Yeah. And 21% only go to church. And one of the reasons that they cited as not going to church was because they didn't agree with their church on politics and social issues. Well, shame on young people like that. Shame on us, okay? Because again, I agree that our politics should be in line with Scripture. And choosing, again, for some of our young people that just graduated, and the next presidential election will be their first time ever to vote. I don't know about you, but I thought I was not excited the first time I was eligible to vote. Of course, I had to vote absentee ballot because I was living in South Carolina at the time, but it was my first time ever to vote. Got to vote for President Reagan. And you know what? Again, it's just a shame that people today don't want the Bible to dictate to them who they vote for. And that'd be a shame for us. Then the last one, George Washington, from his farewell address to the nation, said, "Do not let anyone claim the tribute of American patriotism if they ever attempt to remove religion from politics." Think about that. Again, what has our country become? What would people like it to become in the days that gone by? Again, we'll be celebrating July 4th again, remembering the freedoms that we have. This morning, I'd like you, if you take your Bibles, to turn to the book of Acts chapter 12. And if I could get you for just a few moments this morning, let's view, as we look at Acts chapter 12, let's view this as a day to remember three things. The purpose of man, proclaiming the word of God, and then practicing ministry, okay? Acts chapter 12, let's go ahead and begin. We'll begin with verse number 20 and read down through the end of the chapter. "And Herod was highly displeased with them of Tyre and Sidon, but they came with one accord to him, and having made Blastus, the king's chamberlain, their friend, desired peace, because their country was nourished by the king's country. And upon a set day, Herod, arrayed in royal apparel, sat upon his throne and made an oration unto them. And the people gave a shout, saying, It is the voice of a God and not of man. And immediately the angel of the Lord smote him because he gave not God the glory, and he was eaten of worms and gave up the ghost. But the word of God grew and multiplied. And Barnabas and Saul returned from Jerusalem when they had fulfilled their ministry and took with them John, whose surname was Mark." Again, in verse number 21, it says, "And upon a set day." July 4th is a set day for us to remember the freedoms that we have. Well, God gives us a set day every Sunday to remember what he has done for us. And that is that he gave his only begotten son to die on the cross for our sin. That he was buried and later, 3 days later, he rose from the grave to conquer sin and death, that you and I might have eternal life if we would come and call upon the name of Christ to save us. A set day. So here's a set day that Herod has. And Herod comes and he gives this great speech. But what happens? In verse 22 and verse 23, again it says, "And the people gave a shout, saying, It is the voice of a God and not of a man. And immediately the angel of the Lord smote him because he gave not God the glory." The purpose of man is to glorify God alone. To glorify God alone. Here's an opportunity this day set aside. And again, it wasn't a sinful day or anything that we know of, but we know this. He gave a great speech. It stirred the hearts of the people. And they what? They said, he's a God. Now, it's interesting that God gave him an opportunity to say, hey, wait a minute here. I'm just a man like you. But he didn't do that. He wanted that glory for himself. But when it comes to giving glory, it ought to be given to God and God alone. In Psalm 115, at verse 1, it says, "Not unto us, O Lord, not unto us, but unto thy name give glory." Unto thy name give glory. Isaiah chapter 42 and verse 8 says, "I am the Lord, that is my name, and my glory will I not give to another, neither my praise to graven images." Do we not live in a country, again, unfortunately, that people, what? They want the glory. They want to make a name for themselves. They do not want to give credit to God. They don't want to recognize God. It is all about them. God says this, look, it's not about you. You weren't made about you. You weren't made to boost up yourself or any other man, but to what? To give glory to God. Do we find ourselves again the very same way at times where we ourselves want to take credit for things that belong to God? Giving God the glory, giving God the praise, obedience unto his word. Are we doing that? Again, we need to be careful. We're no different than anybody else. Just like Herod here, we could fall into that same trap. God might give you great abilities to do certain things, and people might lift you up as a high standard. And you know what? You like that. But why are you in that position? because God made you and put you in that position. And God deserves the glory for that. We can't even imagine the glory of God. We can sit there and talk about it all day long. We can read verses on it. But I'm telling you, we glorify God and we will glorify God throughout eternity because of who He is. We just cannot grasp that. We are not going to be able to help ourselves but to give God the glory the moment we see Him. And that glory belongs to Him and Him alone. We ought to always glorify God. 1 Corinthians 10:31, whether therefore you eat or drink or whatsoever you do, do all to the glory of God. Whatsoever you do, are you going to work tomorrow? Well, some of you have the day off, which is good. But even if you have the day off, what do we ought to be doing on our day off? Glorifying God. Have you ever stopped to think about that? You're in the middle of work, or you're in the middle of some project, you're in the middle of doing whatever. Have you ever come to this thought? Well, how do I glorify God in this? How do I give God the glory in what I'm doing right now? Well, again, when the opportunity comes and people want to say, how great a job, you did everything. Well, it wasn't me. It was God. God working in me. God gave me the ability. God did this, not myself. Every opportunity we had to put forth the name of God, we ought to be doing that. Every opportunity. Well, therefore you eat or drink or whatsoever you do as you celebrate the 4th of July amongst friends and family and having a good time, will ever be a thought or a word mentioned about God. Oftentimes, again, I think we take freedom here in the United States for granted as though we are entitled to this freedom. Well, we're not entitled to this freedom. I should say we are entitled because of what people gave and gave their lives for. We're entitled to eternal life. Why? Because Jesus Christ gave His life for us. That's why we're entitled to that. But let's be careful again taking on that mentality as though we deserve it. No, it's God who deserves all that we can give Him. God is just not a curse name. I hope that you are aware of that. You know, it's a shame again, and I'm not talking about lost people, folks, but how often do we take God's name in vain? A name that ought to be what? Magnified and glorified and honored. And we want to bring it down to our level. God will never be at our level. Okay? Even when we get to heaven and we're perfect, God will still not be at our level. Okay? He is God. He is the Almighty. He's the one that deserves every ounce of glory that we can give to Him. But also we see here is something else to remember again. And I say this because, you know, we sometimes just forget. You know, we've fallen into traps. And just like in this country, we just assume that, you know what, as I mentioned, we're entitled to the freedom. We don't ever stop to think about how blessed we are as a country and thankful we ought to be for what people have done in days gone by. But the same is true again here. We find one of the things we ought to be remembering is proclaiming of the Word of God. Look at verse number 24. But the Word of God grew and multiplied. The Word of God grew and multiplied. Would you not like to see that today? The Word of God growing and multiplying. Think about those two words, growing, okay? We all like to see growth, but then it goes on to say multiplied. That's more than just growth. That's exponential growth, okay? That's abundantly, okay? Again, would you like somebody to add to you a dollar? Or would you like them to multiply those dollars every day? I mean, I'll take multiplication any day, okay? Multiply. Notice some things here, again, that we talk about proclaiming the Word of God in times of persecution. We ought to be proclaiming the Word of God in times of persecution. Now, again, we may not be having persecution today, but it is coming, folks. It is coming. You would like to think in 2023 that this persecution would be dwindling, but I've read articles and things that, you know what, it is picking up steam in foreign countries left and right, and I'm telling you, it's a matter of time before it comes here. But we would be persecuted for trusting in Jesus Christ. If you will, turn over a couple chapters to Acts chapter 5. Turn over a couple pages to Acts chapter 5. Acts chapter 5, and let's look at verse 40 through 42, okay? Acts chapter 5, verse 40, where it says this, "And to him they agreed, and when they had called the apostles and beaten them, they commanded they should not speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. And they departed from the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer shame for His name. And daily in the temple and in every house, they ceased not to teach and preach Jesus Christ. Again, we have no idea what persecution is like. But you know what? The apostles did that. Great firsthand knowledge of experience, the persecution, the beatings. For what? For simply preaching Jesus Christ. You know what? Think about that. As we ought to be doing the same in times of persecution. When it comes, will we do that? Will we have conviction unto the Lord? Can you imagine these guys getting beaten? And you know what? They walk away excited and rejoicing that, you know what, they were worthy to suffer shame for the cause of Jesus Christ. And you know what? They went from house to house preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. If we're threatened to be thrown in jail for showing up for church, how many of us would show up? And I'll tell you this. Let's just be honest, okay? Not everybody here today would show up. We know that. If you'll be honest, I'm going to throw you in jail if you show up for church next Sunday. How many of you would stay home? Well, I'll watch church on YouTube. What are you going to watch? Me being arrested? Okay, obviously. But think about it. What was it about these apostles and others who were beaten? It was conviction. They knew that what they were preaching was truth and that every man and woman needed to hear it. That was the compassion that they showed for the lost. They had conviction unto the Lord and had compassion for the lost. Look, if we don't come to church, if we don't preach the gospel, who's going to? During times of persecution, we have got to make up our mind right now that when persecution comes, our convictions for the Lord Jesus Christ are going to stand. And they're going to show forth. We need that. If not, how many people will not hear the gospel? What about in times of peace? Well, it's easy to share the gospel in times of peace. Really? When was the last time you shared the gospel in this time of peace? Now, again, maybe it's not a time of peace in some of our minds. Our world is going through a lot of things at this point in time. But right now, you know what? Here in the United States, still, we still have freedom to gather together. We still have freedom to preach the gospel to anybody, everywhere we go. But in a time of peace, you know what? Sometimes we lose focus of the need of the gospel. Everything seems to be going well. So because everything seems to be going well, we forget that people are still dying and going to hell every single day. Every single day. Every single minute. People are dying and going to hell. In Proverbs chapter 30, verse 9, it says, "Lest I be full and deny thee and say, who is the Lord?" You know, we need to be careful again when things are going well. That, you know what, we remember in this time of peace, if that's what we want to call it, that the gospel needs to be presented. We need to take advantage of it. Because here's one thing I know. If we're going to be arrested, if we're going to be persecuted, if we're going to be beaten publicly for proclaiming the gospel, then we're probably not going to do it. So while we can right now, we ought to take advantage of that, okay? None of us have excuse not to share. We are not, our life is not threatened in that aspect. But notice something else. Again, we talked about the idea of being multiplied. In order to prosper, preach the gospel. Preach the gospel. We're not talking about financially. We're talking about the gospel grew. It began to spread. But it didn't just spread. It multiplied. You know, these people might take it somewhere else. You know what? And they heard and people were saved. And you know what? It was just going everywhere. It was just multiplying. You know what? Wouldn't that be great if that same thing that was taking place right here? Could you imagine 10, 12, 14, 15 people out of this congregation all out on the streets sharing the gospel? But you know what? It doesn't stop there. We have others that live in North Justin. Boom, they're over there. And the people live in Culver. People maybe live in Plymouth. Wherever you may live. You know what? It's not just this area. It's not just one person. But it's us. It's all of us everywhere proclaiming the gospel. That it might prosper. It is extremely important for you and I to share God's word. Now again, I know we all know it. We talk about it often. But again, it is important. You never know who's going to be saved. In Mark chapter 4, you have the story of the parable and the sower. But it says this in verse 8, "And other fell on good ground, and did yield fruit that sprang up and increased and brought forth some 30, some 60, and some 100. We never know the person that we're sharing the gospel with. What God's going to do in their heart and their life. It might not just be that person that gets saved. What? When they come to know Christ, it may be their entire family. And not only that, that begins to be their extended family, and then their friends, then their co-workers. Amen. Who knows what God will do? But you know what? Somebody needs to share the gospel with that one individual first. Yeah. Nobody gets saved, folks, without hearing the gospel. Now, whether you're sharing it with them, or they're hearing it on a radio, or they're being at church, I'm just telling you, everybody has got to hear the gospel in order to trust Christ. And it's up to us to fulfill that command of Scripture. Then verse number 25, we see here the practice of ministry. The three things that we're remembering. And we're talking about 4th of July, a day of remembrance, a day of freedom, remembering our freedom. Here we want to remember again what? The purpose of man. Glorify God and God alone at all times. Number two, proclaiming the word. Again, we all need to proclaim the word. Then here we see the idea of practicing of ministry. Verse number 25 says, and Barnabas and Saul returned from Jerusalem when they had fulfilled their ministry and took with them John, whose surname was Mark. Let's talk about this idea of ministry again. We talk about that a lot at church again. And you know what? I don't know how many people are here today, probably 140, give or take, maybe a little bit more. That the idea again is this, are 140 of us serving the Lord? That's the question. Ministry, practicing ministry. Number one, let's look at this. Always be active. Always be active. Always be involved in ministry. It says in verse 25, and returning from Jerusalem. You know, they don't come and return from this ministry to sit and do nothing. They were always involved in ministry. Everywhere they go, everything they do, they're involved in ministry. You need to be involved in ministry. I need to be involved in ministry. Not just here, but everywhere that I go. Maybe the idea of you being involved in ministry is leading a ministry. Ever thought about that? Leading a ministry. I knew a guy that wanted to serve in ministry. And he asked his pastor about it. You know, what can I do? How can I be involved in ministry? And the pastor said, look, you want to be involved in ministry, start your own Sunday school class. And that man started his own Sunday school class, and it began to grow and began to grow and began to grow. Had over 120 people in his Sunday school class. And the pastor thought, you know, that's a threat to his ministry. So he asked the guy to leave. Okay, 120 people, all because of what? Starting some Sunday school class. You know, sometimes I'm getting this idea that, you know, I want to minister, I want to be involved in things, but you know what? Nothing's going to happen. Well, shame on you for thinking that way, number one, okay? Because remember, it's not about you. And maybe that's what we're looking at. Again, remember talking about glory to who? God alone. But you don't want to be involved in ministry. You don't want to lead some ministry unless you know it's going to be a success, unless you know it's going to grow. So everybody's looking at you. Wow, you have done a great job. Maybe you ought to do some other ministry because you know what? You seem to be able to grow this ministry. How about growing another ministry? It's not about you. Okay, but God does choose to use some of us in leading a ministry. What ministry would you like to lead? What about lending a hand in ministry? Not everybody's cut out to lead a ministry, but everybody ought to help in some way in ministry, lending a hand. How important is it for you to support somebody else? Extremely. Think again about Moses. During the time of the battle and his hands was raised, they would have victory. But you know what? He couldn't stay like that for very long. His arms were grown to be heavy and weary, and they began to sag. And when they came down, what? The enemy took over and began to win the battle. What if everybody had the same attitude back in Moses' day that many of us have today? Well, you know what? Moses better suck it up, okay? If Moses wants to be remembered for victory, he better work harder. Maybe he's not working out enough, you know, at 80 years old. You know, maybe he just needs to work a little. I don't know. But what happened? Aaron and Hur came alongside and held up his arms. Everybody involved in ministry needs help. And many of us can supply that help, again, if we would stop thinking about self and begin to think about others. Do you know that when you're serving others, that you're serving God? Think about it in that aspect. The idea here then also in practicing ministry, strive to accomplish a ministry. Now, is a ministry ever complete? Well, notice what it says here. It says that when they had fulfilled their ministry. You know, not every ministry is a permanent ministry. Okay? Just not. All right? Look, maybe God wants you just to start a ministry. You ever think of that? Just starting a ministry. He may not have you continue with that ministry for years and years and years, but he may have you be the one that comes and begins that ministry, getting it off the ground, and then perhaps eventually turning it over to someone else. What would you be doing? Well, when that time came, you'd be fulfilling that ministry. You'd be accomplishing that ministry. Now, sometimes, again, I think we think that, well, if I started, it's my ministry, then, and if it's going to continue, I have to be the one to. Maybe that's not God's will for your life. Maybe God just puts you in that position and give you that ability just to get it off the ground and let somebody else take over from that point. In John chapter 14, verse 12, it says, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he do also, and greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father." Think about that. Christ came to what? Seeking to save that which was lost. He was here and he proclaimed the gospel. But you know what? He tells the disciples, you know what? You'll do a greater work. Why? Because Jesus' time had come to an end. Right. Now, I'm not saying that God's going to take you home in order to replace you. I'm not saying that. But it's a real possibility, again, that God may have you start some ministry, but then you know what? Turn it over to somebody else. Yeah. Because God wants to use them in that process. Amen. Okay? Again, it's very easy for us to get offended. Because, you know, I started that. That belongs to me. And really, it belongs to God, okay? It's his ministry. Again, talk about short-term ministries. We have lots of short-term ministries, again, that we want to see what? Accomplished. We want to see them fulfilled. We want to see them completed. Think about things like VBS. We don't have VBS all year long, do we? No, we have it 1 week out of the year. It's a short-term ministry. But you know what? Monday through Thursday. And Thursday, what? It was fulfilled. It was complete. We were done with that ministry for this year. What about the Kickstart rally? Again, the Kickstart rally we have once a year. Actually, it's not even just once a year. It's 1 day a year. It's on a Saturday, the first Saturday of May. So if you're making plans right now, parents, don't be taking your teenagers away on the first Saturday in May. They need to be here for the Kickstart rally. Amen. And a ministry, you know, and then at the end of that day, that ministry is complete. There's something about, you know, maybe sometimes we don't get to see the beginning of a ministry and the end of a ministry. But you know what? There are times like this in the short-term ministries that we're blessed and be able to see the start of and the completion of. That's nice. That's great to see what God did on that specific day. Now, again, God may do more than beyond that day, but I'm just saying at that time. What about short-term mission trip? Where you might go for a week, 2 weeks, maybe a month. Again, you know what? You want to finish that ministry as you're there? Sure, okay. Again, I believe, again, God wants us to be involved in ministry and from start to finish. And sometimes your finish date may come sooner than somebody else's finish date, okay? Last thing we want to look at this morning, again, talking about practicing ministry, and that is to train assistants, to train others. Look what it says again at the end of verse number 25. And took with them, after they had fulfilled their ministry, and they took with them John, whose surname was Mark. Paul and Barnabas decided, you know what? Here's a man that we need to help train for ministry. 2 Timothy 2:2 says, "And the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who should be able to teach others also." I want to point out one thing in this verse that's extremely important. As you are looking to train other people, who are you looking for? Well, number one, you ought to be looking for those that are faithful. Amen. Faithful. And I understand that so many people get frustrated and get upset because the church might have some rules. Rules about faithfulness. I mean, think about it. Okay? You know, we're not policing your individual lives, okay? But somebody who shows up for church once a month, is it really right for us to put them in a place where they're going to be teaching Sunday school? Remember, we're looking for and training others. The first qualification is what? Faithfulness. Yeah. Faithfulness. Folks, we need Christian people today who are faithful to the Lord. That's what we need. How can we do anything else for God in the area of service if we're not faithful? Because I'll tell you this right now. People are watching you and they're saying, well, who's that guy to be telling me this when he's not doing that? Amen. Okay? Again, not perfection. But faithfulness. Faithfulness is extremely lacking. Again, as I shared with you this morning about the 21%, it just floors me, folks. I'll just be honest. It floors me. The 18 to 29-year-old people, only 21% attend church. And that is probably just one service a week, okay? Just one service a week. Well, why are the young people doing that? Well, obviously, as I shared with those in that age bracket today, is that, you know, some of them, that's the choice that they have made. They have just decided that now that they can choose and they can choose to do what they want, they choose not to be a part of church. Others, perhaps, you know what? They're really just extending the choices that their parents have made. Yeah. And again, you know, mom, dad, I'm just telling you, if you're going to be at church once a week, one service a week, how much do you think your children are going to be in church? Because you know what? As we have seen over time, life gets busy. I was just talking with somebody the other day about this, you know, technology. Okay, everybody wants technology. We love technology. What is technology for? To make our life, what, easier? Aren't we supposed to have more time now that we have technology? And you know what? Nobody has more time. What do you think about your children? You think they're going to have more time as they grow older? No, they're not. So if you can't find time to be faithful to church, faithful to prayer, faithful to reading the scriptures, faithful to witnessing, do you know what? Your children aren't going to even have that. Right. None of that. And that's why we have 79% that, you know what, they're just gone from the church. In Numbers chapter 12, and here's the thing about faithfulness, by the way, okay? And I'm sure I didn't read more into that, but I've known enough people who, in my lifetime, who go to church just one service a week, usually Sunday morning, service like this. And if you ask them, they'll tell you, well, I'm faithful. I'm not kidding. I've had people tell me, I'm faithful. Really. Again, and we won't get into that. We don't have time. But let me just say this about this. You don't get to choose to call yourself faithful. Right. Think about that for a minute. You don't get to choose to call yourself faithful. God makes that decision. God makes that, whether or not you're faithful. For instance, in Numbers chapter 12, verse 7, my servant Moses is not so, who is faithful in all mine house. Moses did not call himself faithful. God called him faithful. Amen. In Matthew chapter 25, verse 21, his Lord said unto him, well done, thou good and faithful servant. I don't get to say I'm faithful. God makes that declaration. 1 Corinthians 4, 2, moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. Faithful. When it comes to, again, looking to train other people, and Barnabas and Paul did just that, they first looked for somebody who was faithful. Peter says that, and he's talking about we need to find somebody, or Timothy. Timothy says, find somebody who is faithful. Folks, we need faithful people. Faithful people that we can train. For what purpose? So those faithful people in turn would train somebody else as well. Looking for, number one, somebody who's faithful, but also looking for those who have a right focus. A right focus. And this is what I mentioned to you earlier. Right focus on what? On serving others. On serving others. You know, we are so focused on serving who? Now, I know this. Everybody knows the answer, but you know what? If you admit to it, you're going to think, I'm saying I'm guilty. I'm thinking of self. Look, it is self. Okay? That's what we focus on, serving self. How does this benefit me? What am I going to gain from this or gain from that? We're not here to serve self. We are here to serve others. To serve others. And again, as I mentioned to you earlier, serving others is serving God. In Matthew chapter 25 and verse 40, it says, and the king shall answer and say unto them, verily I say unto you, inasmuch as ye have done it unto one of the least of these, my brethren, ye have done it unto me. Wow, that gives you a whole new perspective on serving other people. Wow, if I'm helping them, if I'm doing this for them, you know what I'm doing? I'm doing that for God.
Amen.
Yes, absolutely, we are. We're here to serve the Lord. Again, thinking about things that just happened if we forget about, okay? Every day is the Lord's day, but Sunday is a special day that God sets aside for us, again, to refocus on Him, to remember Him, to remember again that we are to, what? Glorify God. That's our purpose. And that we are to proclaim the Word everywhere we go. And then, folks, again, we need to be practicing serving, practicing ministry. If Jesus Christ came not to be ministered unto, but what? To minister to serve other people. There is no greater example than the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's the example we ought to be following. Every Sunday is not only a day to remember what Christ has done for us, but it is a day to remember what we can do for Him. That's what we need to be thinking about. As you think about the 4th of July coming and what it truly means for us, that the freedoms that we are so blessed with in this country, let's remember the freedoms that God has given us because we know Christ as our Savior. Why don't we go ahead and stand? We'll have a word of prayer. I ask you if you take just a moment to bow your head and close your eyes and nobody looking around. This is just private business between you and God and nobody else. Obviously, I'm looking, but I'm going to be praying for you in just a moment. I won't pray for anybody by name, okay? I'm not trying to embarrass anybody. But I do want to ask you this question. The purpose of all mankind is to glorify God. That's why you're here. You know, sometimes we come to a point in life where what's the point of life? The point of life is to honor and glorify God. That's the point of life. But you know what? If you're here today and you don't know Christ as your Savior, you don't grasp that. You don't understand what it is to live a life that glorifies God. Oh, sure, I'm not asking if you believe in God, because, you know, 80%, used to be 80%, I believe it's far less than that today, and the world believe that there's a God. You acknowledge that there's some type of higher being. I'm not asking you that. I'm not asking if you go to church. I'm not asking if you give money to the church. I'm not asking if you've been baptized. What I'm asking you here this morning, has there been a day in your life where you had confessed to Jesus Christ that you were a sinner and that you needed to be saved? And knowing the only one who could save you was Jesus Christ. And there's a day that you asked Him to save you. Can you remember a time like that? If you don't know that for sure, I'm just telling you, you know what? You're probably not saved. Because God, again, you know what? When you ask that, you remember that. God seals you unto the day of redemption. Once saved, always saved. Amen. You say, you know what, Pastor? If I died today, I'm not 100% sure that I'd go to heaven. Would you please pray for me? Anybody like that? I'll just slip your hand. I'd be glad to pray for you. If you're not 100% certain. Again, I'm not like the bacteria stuff, 99.9. I'm talking about 100%. If you have any doubt, I want to pray for you. Again, my prayer won't save you, but I will pray that you'll understand the gospel of Jesus Christ. What about us as believers again? How many days go by and we just don't remember what it is God would have for us? Glorifying Him, proclaiming His word, and being involved in ministry. We just don't think about those things, and we're not involved in those things. You say, you know what, Pastor, I need to remember what it is God would have for me to do, and I would like to start doing that. Would you please pray for me? Anybody like that at all, just slip up your hand, and I'll pray for you. Anybody like that at all? I see a couple hands there. Anybody else before we pray? All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, again, we do thank You for loving us. We do thank You so much for Your word. Lord, I pray we'd never take that for granted. I pray that we'd be in Your word day in and day out, reading it, Lord, studying it, applying it to our lives. Father, I pray again for the couple that raised their hand, where perhaps, Lord, they haven't been doing these things, Lord, of knowing their purpose to glorify You, or struggling with being involved in ministry or proclaiming the gospel. I pray again that You'd give them the courage during the invitation time they would come and do business with You. Certainly, Lord, we can all use this as a reminder of to serve You more effectively. And Lord, we pray for those that did not raise their hand, Lord, about salvation. You know the heart of every person here. I may not know. The person sitting next to them may not know. But You know whether or not their name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And Lord, if there's somebody here that's not certain about that today, I pray that You'd give them the courage to come forward again so we can show them from Your word how they can know for sure if they died today, they'd spend eternity with You. With heads bowed and eyes closed, the pianist is playing. If God's spoken to your heart about something, the altar's open at this time. Even if you didn't raise your hand, God still spoke to your heart. Let's be obedient unto the word, okay? One of the ways that we honor and glorify God is by being obedient. You may be nervous about coming forward for salvation. I've been there, and probably others just like you have been there. But I'm telling you, if you know God's convicting your heart and you need to be saved, don't let that scare you off. We have people here that love to show you about God's love and show you from God's word how you could be saved today. To play through one more stanza as folks are finishing up praying. Again, you don't have to walk the aisle. I understand that. But I do know this. If God's speaking to your heart, you need to respond by saying yes. You are responding one way or the other. You're responding by saying yes or no, Lord, I'm not doing that today. But that doesn't honor God, again, when you say no. God, we're so thankful again for those who responded by saying yes to you. You convicted them about something, Lord, between them and you. And Lord, they made that right today. For those again, Lord, who responded by saying no, I pray again that you continue to work in their hearts and in their lives. Help them to realize again to honor you, Lord, is by saying yes. And Father, we just ask again that you continue to work in hearts and lives. If there's one here again that's not saved, Lord, may you give them the courage to speak to somebody before they leave here today. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Just reminding, if you didn't already know, there is no choir practice tonight. And tonight, after church, we'll be going to Burger King for some ice cream. Okay? All right.